So, good afternoon everybody. Myself Dr. Revati Kadam.
And myself Dr. Sabha Sir.
So, we are going to take your lecture for today. And the topic for today's tutorial is Human Rights Act, Protocols and Salient Features, Exhumation and Examination of the Mutilated and Charred Bodies, and Crime Scene Investigation. So, it is a bunch of topics are put together today. So let us start with the first part, that is Human Rights Acts. Okay, so as you can see, the Human Rights Act was started in the year of 1993. So the body that governs this act is the National and the State Human Rights Commission. Okay, so the name itself suggests that it is a Human Rights Act, means it is for protection of the human rights. There are 30 basic human rights, out of which what is necessary from forensic medicine point of view is being given in the Article 6, that is right to fair trial. No matter किसी ने कोई किसी भी तरीके का crime commit किया हो, उसके साथ एक fair procedure होगी, fair trial होगा. He will stand in the court and fight fair for his justice, or even if he is convicted, whatever it is. And Article number 7 is no punishment without law. Imagine a scenario where person A has murdered person B. So person A is a murderer, no doubt, he is guilty. But then nobody is going to prove it by, suppose the relatives of the victim will go and kill that person. So he is punished in a way, but he is not punished lawfully, he is not punished by law. So what is important is that the punishment should not be without law. So when all these things are made sure, that is given in the Human Rights Act. So it is for the purpose of protection of human rights. So what are the features of this right? As you can see, it is the important feature of the rights are that the Constitution provides the power to the National and the State Human Rights Commission for a better protection of the human rights. So if suppose there is a case where human rights are violated, then the National and the State Commission can take actions because the power is given to them by the Constitution. So what is described, there is a procedure described for conducting an inquiry. Now do not confuse this with the CRPC, that is Criminal Procedure Code. Okay, in CRPC, same again, procedure for conducting the inquiry is given, how the accused or whoever is being held for the crime, the suspect is going to be tried. The procedure for that is given in CRPC, but here there are some special conditions where how is the trial going to take place is given. So that is different, and over here the procedure for conducting inquiry that is described, this is different. Do not mix the two acts. So the special conditions that I am saying that are, it has important role in police custodial death. So when a person is in police custody and dies, then how do we proceed with this death is described in this act. And also in cases of death in police firing, जिसको बोल सकते हैं कि मतलब when there was some ambush and then police firing के अंदर somebody died, और फिर encounter जिसको कहते हैं अगर हुआ है. So in such cases of death, how do we trial, that will be described over there. And it also, the act also gives protocols for autopsy performed in such cases. So what is the protocol for autopsy under human rights? See, the protocol for autopsy is that if there is any death within police custody, then it has to be reported to the National Commission within 24 hours of death. Okay, so within 24 hours, it has to be informed to the National Commission. Mind you, National Commission has to be informed means the death in police custody is taken so seriously that it is put at national level and everybody is going to be taking care of it. So it has to be, it is a concern of national level. So you should understand how important a death in police custody is. Also, any death in police firing, suppose a death is taking place in police firing, then it has to be reported to the National Commission within 48 hours of that death. Okay, so death in police custody, informed to the National Commission within 24 hours, and death in police firing should be informed to the National Commission within 48 hours. And the medico-legal post-mortem that will take place in such cases, it is not done by one single doctor, but it is done by a panel of doctors. And whatever post-mortem is going on, it is recorded on a video camera, and that video is sent to the commission. Okay, so let us revise the three main protocols, that any death in police custody, informed to the National Commission within 24 hours. Any death in police firing, informed the National Commission within 48 hours of the death. And in cases of conducting a medico-legal autopsy, in these cases, it should be conducted by a panel of doctors, and the autopsy should be recorded and a copy of that recording should be sent to the National Commission. Okay, now let's move ahead. We have a completely different topic now, exhumation, and Dr. Sabha ma'am will take you through exhumation.
Now we'll start with exhumation. Now what is exhumation? Exhumation is out and humus means ground or earth. Now that is, exhumation is defined as the lawful authorized digging of the buried body from a grave. That is rarely done among Hindus as their body is cremated. This requires the magistrate inquest. Here it is done according to section 176 of CRPC. The objectives of the exhumation are done in criminal and as well as the civil cases. In criminal cases, when foul play is suspected, that is to determine the cause of death. In case if the relatives are unhappy about the cause of death given to them, then they can ask for the exhumation to determine the time since death, to know the manner of death, to establish the identity, to recover documents or some other evidential material that may have been buried alongside the dead body. In civil cases, for identification of the deceased in the case of fake documents, setting of inheritance, for accidental claims, insurance purposes, for re-establishing cause of death, when site of graveyard is moved, relatives wish to move the graveyard to the other place. The rules of the exhumation are done according to first class magistrate, that is according to 176 of CRPC. Here in India, there is no time limit for exhumation. Whereas in other countries such as France and Germany, France has an exhumation time limit of 10 years, whereas Germany has for 30 years. This is done in the broad daylight. The graves is duly identified by the relatives and confirmed by the official in charge. The magistrate ordering the exhumation and the team of the doctors should be present, and as well as the relatives should be present over there and the graveyard personnel also.
So let's move on to, this is a third part of the lecture today, that is examination of mutilated, fragmented and charred bodies. So what is mutilated body? A mutilated body is the one which is deprived of a limb or a part. Okay, so some part, some limb or maybe half of the body or whatever is missing, or even if the face is disfigured, it will be called a mutilated body. But in these cases, some soft tissue, some muscles or some skin, some part of the soft tissue might be still attached with the bones. Okay, and what is important is that it is a half or some part is missing, so the entire body of offense, that is corpus delicta, is not available to you. So already some bits and pieces are available, and from that a doctor has to find out the cause of death and has to find out the evidence that he can. So it is a very careful and meticulous examination needs to be done. Whatever parts are available, they should be examined very carefully, and whatever evidence can be derived from it should be derived. So what do you think a doctor will look for in such cases? So basically, doctor is looking for the list that is stated in front of you. You can see on the slide. So first of all, the source. So whatever body parts we have found, what is the source of that body parts? So whether it is human source or animal source, that has to be found out. Because suppose some limb is found fallen in the forest, so it could be of animal as well, right? If suppose part of some skull is found, then whether it is human skull or animal skull, that has to be distinguished first. So we have various aids for that. First is anatomical knowledge. Doctor should know the normal human anatomy. So based on the basic structure and anatomical features of human bones, one, the doctor can find out whether it is a human bone or animal bone. If not, then there is some laboratory investigations like the precipitin test or even advanced test, that is a globulin inhibition test. All these will help you with the identification of establishing the source of the part that is available to us, that is whether it is human source or animal source. Next is that if the part belongs to same individual. Now why is part belonging to same individual or not? Why are we concerned about that? Jo parts hai wo hai na, but it is not like that. See, we need to find out, suppose imagine a scenario where there is a mass casualty. Okay, so 10-15 people have died together in a bomb blast, for example. So there will be so many, mutilated bodies lying all over. So then to make sure that the part belong to same individual, so that a single, body of offense can be formed and the further scene can be investigated. So what can we do here? Blood grouping or maybe DNA profiling, all these techniques will help to find out whether the parts are belonging to the same individual or not. Then what is next is sex or the gender. So we need to find out whether the whatever parts we have obtained are of a male body or are of a female body. Now why do we need to find this? Because a case will be established after that. So we are now proceeding towards identification of the individual from those parts. So as soon as we come to know that, depending upon whatever parts, now when I say parts, what I mean about here is that, see, body is being thrown somewhere in the forest, in the open ground, it has started decomposing. Especially in a tropical country like India, decomposition process starts faster. But there are some organs that resist decomposition. In males, the organ is prostate. It will take time to decompose. And similarly, in females, non-gravity uterus takes time to decompose. So if there are remnants of these organs that can be seen on gross examination, then you can confirm whether the parts are of a male or if the individual is a female. So once you know the, what is the importance of knowing this? Once you know that the body was of male or female, half of the population is excluded. If you know that it was a male, then you don't have to worry about the female population. You bring down your search area to only the male population. And similarly, next step is that finding out the age. So you can estimate the age depending on the state of the teeth, or you can take x-rays and various whatever limbs are available. Suppose a hand is available, you can take help x-ray of the wrist joint or some other parts that are available, the pelvis. All this will give you idea about the age. So age, again, if a range of particular age is found out, so now we know the body is male. We know the male is lying in, suppose what, 18 to 20 age group, for example. So then we are bringing down the search radius, and that is why we are moving closer towards identifying the individual who died. Okay. Next is finding, the next line is the stature. So what is with stature? Stature is the height of the person. So how will we know height of the patient? Now imagine a case where, suppose on a railway track, only half of the body is obtained. So the person does not have anything below the umbilicus. So then how will we know how tall this person was, or you know, when we are moving closer to the identification, how do we specify? So the height of the person is equivalent to the hand span. So from starting the tip of the middle finger of one side to the tip of the middle finger on the other side. So the arm span ka jo width hai, utna hi approximately stature ek insaan ka hota hai. So once you find that out, so like I said in the given example, when the person does not have anything below the umbilicus, but you do have the upper body, right? So you can measure the arm span and you can come to know about the stature. So that is how, again, you know, you are moving closer to identifying whose body it might be. Next is special features. So when I say special features, I mean special features of what? Special features of the person, that he has, suppose he has an extra finger in his upper hand. So polydactyly. So how many people in that age group, being male of that particular stature, might be having polydactyly? This is how you start reducing your search radius and come to a, you know, try to find out the individual whose body parts those might be. Okay. Then of course the race can be found out from the skull, and then time since death and cause of death. Obviously the entire purpose of doing all this, the essence of forensic medicine after all, is finding the time since death and the cause of death. So from whatever parts are available, the doctor will try to find out as many evidence that he can, and he'll try to establish a cause of death as to why this person might. Suppose if there is upper limb available with some fracture in the radius or in the fracture in the whatever bones are available, then we might know that he must have undergone some assault or must have had a huge fall from somewhere. So this is how we'll try to, trauma or assault could be, slowly you can rule it out. So that is how. So let's revise it. What does the doctor look for in a mutilated or a charred body? The doctor will look for the source from where the parts are coming, that is whether it is a human anatomical structure or a something from non-human, something animal. Or if the part belongs to same individual or not, we try to find out the sex, we try to find out the age group that the person belongs to, the stature, any special features which might help to find, identify the individual, the race, the time since death, and the cause of death. So now let's move on to a different topic, that is crime scene investigation, and ma'am will take you through.
Now very interesting topic to see, that is the crime scene investigation. Now what is a crime scene investigation? It is the location where the crime has been committed. Now the goal of the crime scene investigation is to recognize, document and collect evidences at the scene of crime. Now this mainly depends upon the solving of the crime. Then by adding all this, you need to find the evidence to form a picture at what has happened at the place of crime. Evidences are classified as direct evidences and circumstantial evidences. Now, these direct evidences include first-hand observation such as eyewitnesses, accounts, confessions, and circumstantial evidences, also known as the indirect evidences, may imply a fact that does not directly prove, but circumstantial evidence at a crime scene may provide a link between the crime scene and the suspect. Circumstantial evidences can be either physical or biological in nature. The physical evidences include the fingerprints, footprints, shoe prints, tire impressions, tool marks, fibers, weapon, bullets, and shell casing. Whereas the biological evidence include body fluids, hair, plant parts, natural fibers. Here the important role of a doctor is to collect the biological evidences, that is the body fluids, that hair, any fingerprint marks, etc. Here comes the Locard principle of exchange. It states that when two bodies come in contact, cross transfer of the physical evidences occur. That is, when two bodies come in contact, they exchange the fluids among them. That is the Locard's principle. This principle includes such as body fluids, hair, if any of the blood marks, blood stains on the clothes, etc. There are the 7 S of the crime scene investigations. That includes securing the scene, separating the witnesses, scanning the scene, seeing the scene, sketching the scene, searching the evidences, and securing and collecting the evidence. Now, securing the scene, the police should secure the scene completely so no trespasser or anyone can make a crowd over there at the place of the scene. Separating the witnesses, there may be a number of witnesses present over there who may have seen the crime happening or may have committed the crime. Then scanning the scene, the complete scene should be scanned properly so that no evidences should be left. Now sketching the scene, the scene should be properly sketched so that no one can change it afterwards, so that no change occurs and the evidences remains the same. Now searching for the evidences, many of the fingerprints, footprints, shoe prints, tire impression, tool marks, fibers should all be found out at the site of crime. Securing and collecting the evidences. Now these evidences should properly be collected and sent in a paper packet bundle. Should be sent properly in a paper packet bundle and to the lab for the further investigations.
Okay, so like ma'am has already explained, let us go through the 7 S of the crime scene investigation, that is securing the crime scene. See, why securing the crime scene is important is because a crime has taken place and before the investigating team is reaching there, obviously it counts for, you know, attraction. So many people will want to see, come, they're interested, they're curious about it. And so then what happens is it might get just like the Locard's principle of exchange, when two or more bodies are coming in contact. So imagine a crime scene where hundreds of people are coming to see it. So obviously it will be, you know, we can use the word that it will be polluted with evidences which is unnecessary, which is not required. So that is why the crime scene should be secured. Entry only to the people who are related and who are going to investigate, a team of police officers and doctors should be allowed. That is why securing the crime scene is very important. It is followed by separating the witnesses. See, why separating the witnesses is important is because some might have seen the crime happening. Some might be just hearsay witnesses who have heard something, who have heard the screaming and shouting, if suppose it was in the nearby area, if somebody was murdering somebody. So that is how you separate the witnesses, collect detailed information from these witnesses and again put it together as a direct evidence or a circumstantial evidence. Then scanning the scene. See, good observation is very important. When you go through, when you scan the scene properly, when you see if there is small things like blood stains, could be various, any foreign bodies, the weapon that was used for the crime, anything could be lying there and anything from that could be used as evidence. So scanning the scene properly is very important. After that, seeing the scene, the doctor should see for himself. If the doctor cannot depend on how, you know, whatever the police said, that the, you know, particular scene, this area, these things were like this, they were just lying around like this. No, the doctor, if it is possible the doctor should go and see for himself. So seeing the scene, then comes sketching the scene. So next point is sketching the scene. Why sketching the scene? Now let's not really go sketching the scene long back. We can take photographs of the scene. Why preserving the scene, original scene is important is because tampering of the scene can happen later on, is it not? So suppose the trial is taking place after what, say 6 months. By that time the crime scene will be already clean. So many people would have just tampered it. So to make sure that if any changes are made, we should have the original copy of how the scene was when the crime had occurred or when it was being investigated. That is why the scene sketch or the pictures of the scene should be kept, that in this corner of the room the body was lying, in this corner the weapon was lying, here were the blood stains, and it should be like that. And last is the searching for the evidence. Of course, that's the whole purpose of the crime scene investigation. We will search for the evidence and secure and collect whatever evidences we can so that we will have a good case to form. Now let us go back to the revision. Okay, so Human Rights Act, like I said, the governing body is the National and the State Human Rights Commission. The purpose of this is to form the protect the human of their basic human rights. The Article 6 and the 30 basic human rights, but what is concerned with forensic medicine is given in Article 30, that is Article 6, that is right to fair trial and right to no punishment without law. So only law will decide how to convict the accused. It is not somebody, other persons or the victim's relatives, they should not take things or matters in their own hand. So it has to be done by law. After that is the salient features. Okay, so I told you that the Human Rights Act has protocols for what to do when there is a death in the police custody or death in the police firing, and what are the protocols regarding the autopsy to be done in such cases. So what are the protocols when there is a death in the police custody? The death has to be informed to the National Commission within 24 hours. And when there is a death in police firing or what is called as police encounter, the death has to be informed to the National Commission within 48 hours. And when the autopsy is taking place, it should be recorded on a video camera and it should be done by a panel of doctors, and it should be, the copy of that video should be sent to the National Commission.
Now, exhumation, that is a lawful authorized digging of the buried dead bodies into the grave, that is rarely done among the Hindus. In India, there is no time limit for exhumation, whereas in other countries such as France and Germany, France has for 10 years and Germany has for 30 years. This needs a magistrate inquest, that is according to section 176 of CRPC. Here, objectives of the exhumation include the criminal and the civil. When the foul play is suspected, in the cases to determine the cause of death, time since death, manner of death, and to establish the identity to recover the documents. In the civil cases, for the identification of the deceased in case of fake documents, setting of inheritance. For accidental death claims, for re-establishing cause of death when site of graveyard is moved, or when relatives wish to move the graveyard from grave to other place. Now, rules of exhumation, at the place of the site of grave, there should be presence of the first class magistrate, the doctor, the police and the relatives to identify the grave. This is done in the broad daylight. The grave is duly identified by the relatives and is confirmed by the official in charge.
So what I would like to clarify in this slide is that rules of exhumation, see the very first rule, that the body can be exhumated only on a written order by a first class magistrate. Now this magistrate, the magistrate can be a judicial magistrate or it can be a executive magistrate, but it has to be a magistrate only. No matter whatever high rank police officer is present, he cannot order exhumation. It has to be done by a first class magistrate only. And in India, like ma'am said, there is no time limit for ordering any exhumation. So whenever there is a case or whenever any foul play is suspected or objection is raised, you can go for exhumation only when there is a written order by a first class magistrate. Okay. Now we have examination of mutilated and fragmented bodies. Okay. So what are mutilated bodies? Mutilated bodies are those which are deprived of any limb or part or any disfigurement of the face, which is causing difficulty in identification, will be the mutilated bodies. And what does the doctor have to do during examination? The doctor has to find out a few things. The first thing being the source, whether the parts are of a human source or an animal source. And how do we find this out? We have either by anatomical structure of the various parts that are available to us. If it is matching with the human anatomy, then we know it is human part. Or by test, laboratory test like the precipitin test, which is done on bones, or the globulin inhibition test. Globulin inhibition test is a very sensitive test. It is more sensitive than precipitin test, but is also very time consuming and needs better technology. So might not be available at every center, but that's also, you know, a test that is available. And then the doctor also has to find out if the parts belong to same individual, which will be helpful to establish a corpus delicti and hence identify the individual. The sex of the patient, like I said, organs of regeneration like prostate and a non-pregnant uterus, they take time to decompose. So even if a body is decomposed to some extent and these parts are available, we can still segregate whether a person is male or female, and accordingly we come down to identification. And then age group. So age can be estimated from the dental status of the patient or from the length of the humerus, length of the femur. Even if one single bone is available, there are various formulas that are given with respective constant numbers that are to be multiplied with the length of the bones that are available, and that is how stature. If not, if suppose half of the body is available, then like I said, the arm span will help. The from middle finger, tip of middle finger of one hand to the tip of middle finger of the other hand, that distance is almost equivalent to the stature of the person. Any special features if the person has, suppose like I gave an example of polydactyly, or maybe syndactyly, or the patient might be having some other tattoo mark or whatever, some special feature that is anatomically present could be found out, and the race of the patient depending on the skull and the time since death and the cause of death. So all these things are to be found out by, as you can see the list, these are the things the doctor looks for in a mutilated and a charred body, so that cause of death can be established and identity of the parts that are available, so whatever individual that was could be identified.
So now we start with crime scene investigation. The crime scene is in any location that is associated with the crime. The goal of the crime scene investigation is to recognize, to document, to collect the evidences. Now collecting all this, for solving the crime, we need to collect all these three to at the place of crime. Evidences that can be classified as the direct evidences and circumstantial evidences. Now direct evidences include the person who has seen the crime, or who passerby, or the first hand observation such as eyewitnesses, confessions. And the circumstantial evidences, also known as the indirect evidences, that can be used to imply a fact but does not directly prove it. But circumstantial evidences at a crime scene may provide a link between a crime scene and the suspect. The circumstantial evidence can either be physical or the biological in nature. Physical include the fingerprints, the footprints, the tire marks, blood stains, anything. Whereas the biological includes the body fluids, hairs, any plant material, plant parts, or any of the natural fibers. Here the Locard's principle of exchange. It states that when two bodies come in contact, cross transfer of physical evidences occur. That means when two bodies are coming in contact with each other, they share some of the traces, some of the evidences, such as any of the body fluids, anything that may show evidence to us at the place of crime. There are the 7 S of crime scene investigation. As ma'am had explained to you about all the 7 S, I'll just repeat them: securing the scene, separating the witnesses, scanning the scene, seeing the scene, sketching the scene, searching for evidence, securing and collecting evidence.
Okay, so we have made an attempt to explain as much as we could to the best of our abilities. I hope this lecture will help you with your doubts, and if there is anything, please come back to us and ask your doubts. So yes, thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you so much.